Good morning. My name is Heather Dino. I'm a mayor district councillor. I'm also the deputy mayor. I'm also the council liaison of the Active Transportation Policy Council, which is also a rock star group of volunteers and citizens who give us a lot of the advocacy cover we need to make the bold decisions that we make. So I was asked to talk about bold decisions today. But before I start, I also would like to acknowledge that we are not only on the traditional territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh, we are on the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh. We acknowledge that as a city, and Deborah's welcome means the world to us. So thank you to Deborah and to all of our host stations for allowing us to live, work, play, have conferences, walk, and everything else here in their territory. First of all, comment. I was going to wear a t-shirt today. It was about bold political action, about the Hornby bike lane. It says, "Bike lanes make me Hornby." But that just seems to be slightly too bold at the time. It's still too soon. So I'm not going to I'd like to first of all, how many elected officials are in the room? Elected officials, boldly raise your hands. Yeah, okay, so there's a smattering of us. So our job is to take the excellent work done by staff and to give the direction for that excellent work, to support them in their work, and then to go out and talk to the media about it and take the resulting actions from the public, which is pretty exciting sometimes. So first of all, I'll talk about the history of bold actions here in the city. This is not a new thing for us. Back in the 1950s, a group of citizen advocates stopped the freeway from coming through the city. Now, I'll bet that most of you live in cities that have a freeway that goes through downtown. Seattle is our closest example, and I was driving through Seattle just recently on the way to a festival, and it's a dog show. It's a dog's breakfast trying to get through that city, and there's this massive freeway system that goes right through downtown. Well, back in the 50s, some really progressive, very determined and stubborn people stopped the freeway from coming into the city of Vancouver. And we still have the benefit of that today. We are still one of the most easy to get around downtowns because there's no big wall of freeway right down the middle of our city. But there were two stubs of the freeway that were built. And those are the viaducts. The viaducts are here. And we made a decision recently to take those out. Another bold step. We're going to rip those down and we're going to rebuild the city. Neighborhoods is going to make it much easier for all modes of transportation to get in and out of the downtown core when you're going to the east. So we also have a number of plans. Now plans are a great way to make bold actions because they're actually not actions, they're words. So we write these plans with these great goals of zero fatalities and 50% transportation mode being by cycling, walking, or transit by 2020. Oh wait, we hit that goal in 2015. Green City has some great goals. Renewable city. We have a healthy city strategy with lots of really bold goals. But how do you turn those as a politician into action? So let me give you a brief story about the Broad Street Bridge. It's been mentioned already. Many of you have probably seen it. It's just south of here. So back in the 1990s, it was recognized by politicians of all stripes. It was a very unsafe bridge for pedestrians and cyclists. Pedestrians and cyclists were sharing very narrow sidewalks on a heritage bridge, and the sidewalk, for safety reasons, was perched extra high above the roadbed as a car barrier. So you had this high-perched, narrow sidewalk that was shared between cyclists and pedestrians. And all it took was one pedestrian with their grocery bags in their hands, and a cyclist could get knocked into the traffic barrier, so the pedestrian could be. So even back in the 1990s, there was an attempt to make that a safer place. So the city leaders of the day decided to close down one of the lanes of cars and open up to cyclists. Convert the lane, not close the lane, it's still open. But they chose the wrong lane. They didn't do the marketing and the awareness building they needed to do. And they chose the one lane that was most prone to backing up on the bridge. And they converted it to cyclists. Mayhem and chaos ensued. People were very angry. Within a matter of weeks, it was open to cars again. And I was living here by the time, how disappointing that was. I wasn't in politics yet, still working as a biologist. And to see that, the loss of that safe lane getting over that bridge was really sad. Over the ensuing years, several councils tried to find a way around taking space away from the beloved car. And one of the considerations was adding wings onto the outside of the bridge for bike lanes on the outside that would have been very expensive and would have been a real detriment to this precious heritage bridge. So finally in 2008, I was part of the team that selected the mayor, Mayor Robertson. I was already on the council, but I hadn't been there with the mayor that believed in cycling the way Mayor Robertson does. And all of a sudden, we were no longer going to talk about this, we were going to do it. So in 2009, we did a lot of work. Our staff were amazing. They made sure that we had the right lane chosen. They made sure that there was a huge awareness building campaign. They made sure out there and they converted that lane. There were helicopters circling overhead. There were reports failing to sound kind to the media. Oh, yay. And there was like this bank of cameras around me. As I rode over the bridge, somebody was interviewing me with a microphone from their bike. Thanks for a great photo. And my favorite is that one of the car-oriented radio stations had a booth set up on the downtown side of the bridge to talk to people in their cars as they were caught in the ensuing gridlock. Carmageddon was coming. So we were ready for it. We had a lot of cycling advocates out there. We got great local advocates here. And we crossed that bridge, and there was a, it happens to be a camera on top of a building nearby that has that bridge in sight. We went over the bridge, we did all the media, we went back to City Hall, and we watched that camera all day long. It never happened. The slowdown never happened. It was at the very most, at the peak inconvenience over the next several months, was a maximum of 6 minutes for people who were trying to do a rabbit run through the West End to get around to the bridge. And that was the maximum Carmageddon chaos in the end of the world that happened for the Burrard Bridge, blame the inversion. But there was a problem with it. Mobility is what we're talking about here today, and pedestrians were all put to one side of the bridge because one car lane diverted to bikes going one direction. Bikes were on the sidewalk on the other side, a new barrier in place, and pedestrians were all pushed to one sidewalk. Not perfect, especially when you say you put pedestrians first. So last year we made the decision to do all the heritage redo and the structural upgrades we need to do on the bridge, fix the north end intersection, that's what you see just down here, and convert another lane. And we got ready. We got ready for Carmageddon again. I got my Kevlar out. I had all the evidence in the world, and I was like, bring it. Bring it. It never came. Like the opposition showed up to complain about impacts to the heritage aspects of the bridge. There was one person who came out and spoke about the car situation. It turned out that person had a link to the Automobile Association. So that was the person they could find to come out and complain about converting another lane to cyclists. So I suspect when we open it, there'll still be some, well, you didn't tell us you were doing this going on, but we're pretty excited about that. So that was something that we were able to do because we had all the leadership we needed from staff, from politicians, from advocates around the table. And since then, we've made another decision, because of the Breakfast Canada, we think the Arbutus Corridor, Rails to Trails, Transportation Corridor, north-south, right through the city on the west side, and we bought it. We bought it for $55 million, and we are converting it to a transportation of all modes, all active transportation corridor, and right now we're in the midst of overcoming some opposition from the neighbors who realize that this means that a lot of the public is going through their backyards. So that's very localized, very personal opposition from a few homeowners who didn't really understand that when the city gets this corridor, it becomes a public road. It's going to be amazing. It is going to be something that puts us on the map in the future. We're so proud of that. So what do bold political moves require? They require confidence and conviction that the outcome of what you're doing is positive. And if you have evidence to base that on, if you have great researchers like we have here, and the staff work has been done, all the better. But somebody has to do it without evidence the first time. So evidence-based where possible, bold conviction and confidence that what you're doing is the right thing for the broader public. You need willingness to take risks. You need to be able to say, if I lose this next election, because this turned out to be very unpopular, so be it, it's the right thing to do. You need organized advocates. We have great ones here at Hub and our Active Transportation Policy Council here in the city. You've seen and heard from a lot of them real this week. And you need staff who've got your backs in spades. And our staff are the ones who make this happen. We can say those words out there every day, all day. But without staff to back you up and make it successful and make sure we get it right, you're going to fail. So I tip my hat to Dale and the entire team at City Hall. I tip my hat to the mayor for his leadership and their city manager. And I took it back to the public who have come out and said in all this data that you're seeing in that booklet, yeah, you're doing the right thing. So that's what it takes to make bold political decisions in my mind. We still have the opposition out there. They think they're hashtag winning when they oppose the bike lane still, so I don't know what they're waiting from. Not mine. Hashtag losing as far as I'm concerned. Anyway, so to conclude, plans and actions are bold. To actually make your actions bold is one thing, but we have a goal in our transportation. 2040 plan is one of my favorite goals, and it is, it shouldn't just be bold, it shouldn't just be successful and safe, it should be delightful. And as I leave the stage, there's going to be another speaker before Charles, but when Charles comes up here, he embodies what it is to be delightful in the city of Vancouver. Thank you.